This is Susan Wingrove-Reed. I'm the education consultant for the Anchorage Symphony Orchestra and also principal keyboard player. And it's a great pleasure to welcome Elizabeth to our chat about the grand finale of this year's season. Elizabeth, it's flown by, oh my goodness, from fall to now. And here we are with the grand ending.
I know. I just, what a season it's been so far. It's just gone from strength to strength.
Absolutely. The orchestra's really on a roll, and we finally got to do a young people's concert, which we hadn't been able to do since COVID hit, and that was a huge success doing the Carnegie Link Up program. So we're hitting some strides again. So good.
Yeah, that was particularly meaningful for me that went over as well as it did, and I look forward to continuing that that program in Anchorage. I think it
absolutely
should be great.
I know, speaking for myself and other players in the orchestra, we were so excited. You could feel the vibe in the audience with the kids, and everybody had a wonderful time. So looking forward to next year, but we still have this year. So let's talk a little bit about the program for our finale. And we're beginning with a piece called Masquerade by Anna Klein. And I wanted to ask you, first, how you became aware of Anna and this piece. And then I just love reading about it. There's a quote I found where it's like this, it's like an exciting roller coaster of 5 minutes of musical colors and excitement. So what are your thoughts about the opening piece?
Well, Anna, believe it or not, was a student at the National Conducting Institute, I would say in the early mid 2000s. Where I was teaching and assisting Leonard Slatkin, who was the, of course, was directing that program with the National Symphony and at the Kennedy Center. And I remember her very well. She was a composer who wanted to get trained in conducting. I mean, she was already accomplished, already quite brilliant, on the cusp of really hitting it big. And she was eager to learn conducting techniques so that she could conduct her own works, which a lot of composers actually do in order to get their works played, especially when they're younger. They often have to gather musicians together and put on their own show, very much as Beethoven did with his subscription concerts and others. Beethoven conducted his concerts, Schumann, we have Mendelssohn, Wagner. We have lots of stories about composers conducting, of course, Lully with the big stick that went through his foot and caused gangrene and killed him in the, eventually. But not to digress too much, I was always impressed with her. Very intelligent, very focused, very curious, and all the things that you would expect in someone who is a composer, a fine musician. She brought everything to the table. And it was only a few years later when we heard her music really coming to the fore. I'm not really sure when Masquerade was out. Was it 2007 or was it earlier than that?
It was 2013.
13, okay. Yeah, I think I saw her around 2000, I don't know, 4, 5, 6, I'm not sure. So it would be a few more years before perhaps she hit the big time in the world. This was a piece, I think, that put her on the map. Maren Alsop was conducting the BBC orchestra, I think, and at the proms. And this was written as a commission. I believe that Maren had commissioned Anna Klein in previous works as well. Yep. So, Anna was Anna Klein was known as a composer, and this was a piece that was, I mean, it's delightful, 5 minutes of fun. And it was, I think it was written specifically for the audience to celebrate a proms-like audience, a group of people coming together in a classless situation, which is rare in England, but at the proms, everyone has an equal seat, basically. And since it was written for people coming together, you know, it's a wonderful opportunity for us to play a piece that invites the audience in immediately, engages them, and harkens back to audiences of old and the revelries that were involved. how people could put masks on and walk amongst each other, not knowing each other's personal story, but being equal, all being equal, and equal fun for all as well. It really, well, it, she uses an old song as part of the thematic material. She's incredibly inventive in her instrumentation and use of orchestral color. And it goes by very quickly, but it is completely engaging and enjoyable.
Well, we're so excited to present it. And it's a wonderful, as I read in another review, it's a wonderful appetizer for an evening of orchestral music. So
indeed, indeed. It promises, it opens the door to revelry and excitement and, and gives a sense of anticipation as well.
Yes. So the anticipation is set for Tchaikovsky Piano Concerto Number 1, featuring guest artist Yulia Gorenman. And Yulia is a pianist who I have originally met at the Sitka Music Festival. And I was telling some of our symphony staff that she did a performance of her transcription of Scheherazade at one of the concerts there a few summers ago. And then she shared with me afterwards, we were all blown away by the colors she got out of the piano. And she shared, yeah, maybe someday I'm going to have time to write this down. But she had it completely from inside her head, and she's never written the score down, 45 minutes long. So Yuli is a genius. But so Tchaikovsky won. How did this piece get to be settled that this is what you wanted to do with Yulia? And what do you love about conducting and working on this piece with a terrific pianist like she is?
Well, I've known Yulia since the 1990s when we worked together. She performed Rachmaninoff, I think, third piano concerto. Mm-hmm. It might have been the second or third piano concerto with the National Symphony in May. And it was a wonderful experience. And we've been friends ever since, very close. And she just sent me a text of her playing a portion of the Tchaikovsky, so I already know how absolutely gorgeous it's going to be. I mean, everyone's in for a treat. She is a individualist in that she has her own way of approaching every piece. And she starts from scratch. She's probably played the Tchaikovsky First Piano Concerto a million times. All right. Yeah. Hundreds of times, and yet it's clear that she goes back and rethinks it, and I really appreciate that energy that she puts into her preparations. She has great passion, great color, great force in her playing, and it's a complete joy. We're always on the same wavelength. We've, at least to this point, I don't think I've performed Tchaikovsky with her before. I've done a number of concerti with her, from Beethoven, which is her special love, to Rachmaninoff. We've done the Rhapsody. We've done all the concertos, 2, 3, and that, and then some others. But I'm looking forward to Tchaikovsky with her because it's such a standard work, but it also is a crowd pleaser for a reason. And it is written with the Tchaikovsky. Of course, we're doing the latest iteration after it had been vetted and played all over, including the United States, where I believe it had its world premiere.
In Boston. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But it had two more iterations as virtuosi took on the piano part and sent him letters suggesting changes. Like the first opening chords that the piano, those used to be arpeggiated, that kind of idea. Just things that give it a little bit more power and presence. I love it that Tchaikovsky had this from, I think, was it the 1860s on through the 90s or something like that, or the late 80s. He really spent time with it. He revisited it and updated it. And so I feel like we have his final thoughts. And of course, at that point, then we have him at the height of his powers, so that he is going to be able to polish. And I think it was always a special piece for him because he had to fight to make it happen. I think there was a rejection at the beginning, and although those people eventually came around, they were, it's got the kind of Beethoven audacity in that it starts in the wrong key. You know what I mean? It's, you know, he's messing with the structure and the form and the expectations of the time in which it was first written. And by the 1880s, 1890s, of course, other people had done that, or he had already done that. And so it was considered vernacular at that point.
In fact, I've wondered yeah. about the dates of the way the piece developed, because when Nikolai Rubinstein was so critical of it, when he first shared it with him and then said it's unplayable, et cetera, et cetera. And then Hans von Bülow played it in Boston, but then from there it evolved. And I was reminded that Nadezhda von Meck, his patron, who had written him out of the blue to offer him money so that he could quit his conservatory job and just focus on composing, then that was well underway when he was then pursuing the revision opportunities. Right. So he was able to totally focus on composition because of this incredible opportunity of a sponsor. So that's right. an historical note, all the what right. ifs.
Yes, absolutely. And as I say, I think it was a piece that traveled with him for a while, where that initial rejection caused him to always question and look and accept suggestions from outside, even though he basically said, I'm not changing a thing for Rubinstein.
Right.
Eventually, he did change a couple things. And eventually, Rubinstein endorsed it and performed it. So.
No, it's a great story.
But and I think the partnership with the Anchorage Symphony and Yulia is going to be spectacular. She is the kind of person that everyone will warm to and embrace. She's a incredibly caring and loving person, an outsized personality, great heart, and she wears her heart on her sleeve, and
yes.
A great presence as well. She really harkens back to a tradition of, I would just say, the Russian tradition of piano. I'm not sure of all who are teachers. I know that, of course, she studied in the United States as well as in Russia. Ukraine, yeah. I think it was. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And she had great teachers. But the tradition coming from that, I wouldn't be surprised if she could trace it all the way back to Rubinstein on some level.
Yeah.
Probably back to Beethoven.
Probably yeah. so. Yeah, it's going to be so exciting to finally have Yulia in Anchorage. So this is really going to be thrilling.
She's looking forward to it too.
Oh yeah, she's made that really clear. So, and so Tchaikovsky after the Masquerade. I mean, what a treat of a program! And then the feast concludes with one of the great orchestral color masterpieces of all time, "The Pines of Rome" by Respighi. And it's been a while since the orchestra's played it, but it's certainly a favorite, and it's so fun to just immerse in the storytelling and the colors of this amazing piece. What is your history with the Pines of Rome, and why did you select this to be the conclusion of your first full season of our music director?
Well, there's so many reasons. Some are contemplative in that the final grand tone poem, the fourth of the four, it harkens back to a time, ancient time, and the sound of the Roman guards going up the Appian Way, and which is an old road that still exists, mm-hmm. and it goes all the way through to Rome from, I can't even remember, but it's extraordinary. You can still walk it. It still has the stones in the ground that were put there, you know, over 1,000 years ago or something like that. So there's a sense of tradition of the orchestra from the past moving, presenting itself. Here we are now. I find that pieces that look back and bring an imagination, a creative story with it, sometimes are very evocative for audiences, but can also have special meaning for audiences of today to be hearing the sounds of the past as filtered through what would have been the present day, the 1920s, which was a very modern time, which was a very, very avant-garde and forward-looking time before the World War, well, right between the wars. There was a sense of rebuilding, but there was a sense of history. There was a sense of what's been lost. I mean, there was just so much going on in the 1920s. The fact that it is, it's basically from, it's a whole cycle of a day. I believe it begins at the beginning of the day and then ends kind of again at dawn, you know. I mean, it goes through dusk in the gardens and all of those things like that. I just find it very evocative. It reminds me of the great gardens of Spain that Faya wrote. And it's got all the color. Of course, Rashbigi studied with Rimsky-Korsakov, one of the great Russian composers, a master of orchestration. Rashbigi took all that he learned. And if I'm not mistaken, so did Ravel. Did Ravel also have a connection to Rimsky? It's just that all these great colorists, the orchestra became, it's almost as if there was an incredible blooming of orchestral color in the early 19th century, 20th century, 1920s or so, where it just everything emerged. The color possibilities were even more pronounced. Certainly we had all of that going on in French music from Berlioz on, but not in the same ways, not in the same way, and not with the same rhetoric of evoking the past or evoking nature in a different way. The evoking of children playing, the birds singing in the quiet, the nightingale, I mean, in the middle of the night, there's just certain things that are just so evocative and special and bring us to a place. It's a perfect travelogue movie in sound, but it's more than that. And it's written by someone who has deep feelings for the history of the country that he lived in. And it's a way of preserving, but also bringing fresh eyes. And there was all of that. There was nationalism going through music at the time. He was truly the first Italian composer that wasn't known first of all for his opera. I mean, he did write opera, obviously, but he was also known as, his piano concerto, his violin concerto. He wrote in the more standard orchestral traditions, and he really was one of the first that really stood out in the 20th century. Of course, we have others from the 19th century, but really he occupied a very important place, especially around the 1920s. And he brought his music all around the world. It was immediately accessible to audiences. They appreciated it.
The Fountains of Rome really established him internationally, and then Pine, and the whole triptych of the Pines. It's just a fascinating historical story, but more it's about him as a humane person who really loved his country and his music. And he was very connected to emotion in music. The melody and the colors of,
well, he's Italian, so the opera, what can I say? I mean, he really, it's not only Rimsky color, the colors of Rimsky-Korsakov and beyond, but it's also the passion and the emotion of opera. It's just imbued in, I mean, when you think of Luciano Berio, who was a much more contemporary composer, again, or Dalla Piccola, any of those people. Dalla Piccola wrote in 12 tones, you know, but it was filled with emotion. I mean, everything, it's just the sense of the Italian operatic connection, communication, and beauty, always beauty, beauty of line. And you get the beauty of line throughout. And even, I mean, when you think of the song, of course, we have the birds singing as well.
Yeah.
And that brings up Messiaen, everybody else who are trying to reach to nature and trying to find the truths in melody and things like that. So there's a lot going on. And he managed to, just create these beautiful sound worlds for the audience. And there's a grandiosity to it. And I think it's just a way of telling our audience, you ain't heard nothing yet, you know.
Yeah.
We have, you know, it'll be a great way to set us off on the next,
absolutely,
next season, which will also be full of color and new voices. And along with the meat and potatoes that people expect, we will also have a lot of wonderful guest artists and things to look forward to. So
absolutely. So it's going to be a wonderful cap to what's been a terrific season. The orchestra is so excited, and there have been glorious concerts, and this will be added to cap the list. And then off we go, and there's going to be some exciting news coming out soon for everyone who is part of our family to know what is to be expected for next season, and anticipation, and the Atwood Concert Hall coming alive with live music and musicians and you and our audience coming together, because there's just nothing quite like experiencing it in the room together when we're making music that's heard and we feel that the intensity of the audience.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah, we look forward to seeing everyone there. It's going to be a wonderful way to finish up a very exciting season.
With smiles on our faces as we exit the hall, first Alaska summer and then being back in the fall. So Elizabeth, thank you so much. It's been a terrific year. We look forward to next year and continuing this evolution and of the orchestra with you. And here's to you, our audience. Thank you for being part of our family, and let's see you in the concert hall for our grand finale.
Absolutely. See you in the Atwood.
Thank you.